Welcome to everyone. My name is Olivia Longo and I am an Associate Professor of Architecture and Urban Design at the University of Brescia. My contribution aims to analyze the influence of the Cold War atmosphere on the works of the Italian architects who designed and built between the 1940s and 1980s. It consists of a collection of observations from their thinking and writings. In 1998, Leonardo Benevolo wrote his book L'architettura nell'Italia contemporanea, where he used a series of Italian movies to describe Italy in the post-World War II. He quotes Roma città aperta in Paisà by Rossellini, Sciuscià and Ladri di biciclette by Vittorio De Siga, using their scenes to describe the Italian landscape of that period. Benevolo affirms that in those post-war years, he and his coetaneous architects chose to take an important distance from previous older architects' generation because they need to create an architecture from an external and objective reality, using the unique word realism. Benevolo affirms that to write the story of the post-war Italian architecture, he cannot ignore the climate of that period, the detachment from myths, the scruples of objectively verifying and accepting with reservation the experiences of others. As Gardner, Nichols, and White asked in 2012 on Italian art, can Italian architecture be considered contaminated by Cold War effects? Post-war Italian art was affected by geopolitical context of the Cold War in two significant ways. First, after a period of cultural autarky in which fascist Italy was increasingly isolated politically, economically, and culturally from a great part of the Western world, there was an explosion of interest by Italians in the United States. Second, due to Marshall Plan Aid and other efforts by Americans to harness Italy for a new democratic and capitalist Europe, resources, organizations, and people flooded into the country from the USA with enormous impact, creating vibrant international art colonies in cities such as Rome, Venice, and Milan. This research will explore this attitude of the Italian architects based on a feeling of mistrust and detachment caused by the suffering that World War II had brought to society at that time. There are many theories that can let we believe that this feeling was alimented by the particular cultural atmosphere of the invisible Cold War, began first few years after the end of the Cold War, of the Second Conflict. The Cold War was not only a political military confrontation, but a way of life, an atmosphere that conditioned society in all its dimensions. A daily lived and suffered in a climate of absolute mistrust and fear that led to the birth of the so-called culture of suspicion, a way of conceiving and looking at the other as an enemy, the one who lived behind the iron curtain, behind the wall. Involving various cultural sectors and using intelligence activities and the technological espionage, the race between the two superpowers manifested itself through complex propaganda systems. The decade question of secret relations between the CIA and the anti-communist part of Western Europe was reconstructed and published in England in 1999 by Frances Stonor Sanders. She wrote on little-known, submerged, and even occult aspects of our recent history and cites many of the most outstanding names of the 20th century. Brains promoted by the American Secret Service to counter communist influence. FBI and CIA financed and produced films, American films both reflected and projected official Cold War ideology, consciously and unconsciously. The result was thousands of images that helped millions of people worldwide to grasp the real meaning of a conflict that was peculiarly abstract and on an imaginary level. For better or for worse, the Cold War in fact produced a phase of cosmopolitan intercultural exchange based on the creation of new global networks previously non-existent on this large scale, and the spirit of collaboration between critics, artists, and the public. In 1978, Giulio Carlo Argan and Christian Norbert Schulz organized an international exhibition in Rome entitled Roma Interrotta. The title paraphrases the name of an editorial column edited by Luciano Patetta, L'architettura interrotta, published in the magazine Controspazio, directed by Paolo Portoghese. A column dedicated to architecture made of paper, or in any case in a condition of suspension, of unnatural, intentional, or provoke arrest. The exhibition was attended by Robert Venturi, Aldo Rossi, Paolo Portoghesi, James Stirling, among others. As Patetta said, the architecture shown was characterized by an unrealism that at the same time denounced the impotence to which architecture was forced. But there was also the allusion to an alternative reality. Francesco Zuddas wrote in 2015 that after an observation of student unrest between 1963 and 1968, when the university spilled out onto the streets, in the essay The Overturned Pyramid, De Carlo wrote, "Only when institutions are interrupted can total experience be reached." In an interview with Franco Bunciuga, De Carlo declares that after the 1950s and the disappointment of communism, he has returned to anarchist thinkers, rereading their writings and reflecting on the meaning that efficiency can have in order to achieve significant results. He affirms that these principles have been his starting point for architecture and urbanism. In this way, De Carlo confirms that it is possible to have a project without keeping the goals fixed, because they will continuously adapt to the circumstances, to the counter. In this way, for De Carlo, the project becomes much more effective and interesting. In one of these writings, De Carlo stated that architecture and town planning are fundamentally authoritarian because architects and town planners have provided their services to power and have therefore elaborated theories, solutions, and projects in line with the clients. There were, however, different ways of being and of conceiving the relationship of human beings with the territory. A deeply anarchic thought that consists in not specializing the human environment, in not dividing the great territory from the city, the neighborhood, the building, but to see everything together as a place where human life takes place, recognizing at different scales their common belonging to a phenomenon from which they don't want to separate themselves. In 1945 in Milan, the AR plan was drawn up, the first to address the overall problem of the reconstruction of Milan. In the same year, the Movimento di Studi per l'Architettura was founded, an association of architects to which Vittoriano Vigonò also belongs. The movement criticizes the dogmatism of the modern movement and seeks a rationality understood not as a style, but as reasonables of the design approach, a desire for clarity, intelligibility of forms and the attempt to establish a relationship with the place. A personal interpretation of the rebellion against the modern style can be recognized in the Beton Group of the Istituto Marchion di Spagliardi, designed by Vigano in Milan, expression of an experimental didactic and educational program. In 1992, Marco Dezibardeschi wrote on the Vigano's work that in Milan during reconstruction, they were the years of the tribute to a structural rigor and sincerity, of the absolute identification between form and through, of research in the natural use of poor materials, such as reinforced concrete, and into new and original forms of beauty, rough but sincere. In Milan, since 1970 to 1985, Vigano designed the School of Architectural Addition as a sublimated factory of knowledge, but within the systematic doubt and continuous re-evaluation of any assumed certainty. This concept has been identified with the sign mounted on the facade of that stylized and colossal red A, in which the symbol of architecture coincides with the freedom of anarchy. In the United States, the unusual success of Leonardo Rich's book, Anonymous 20th Century, is symptomatic of a widespread need for architectural culture in the 1960s. The union between modern forms and old or reactionary content carried out by the neo-capitalism of the time put in crisis the certainty of values of 1920-1940. From this came the push to dematologias and repropose from scratch the question of living. For this reason, Rich's existential position is much appreciated. In his book, Rich declared that the architect as a single hero was finished, while as a social hero he was yet to born. He questions every aspect of man's life, affirming that we must re-examine not the house but the living, not the factory but the work, not the hospital but the sick, etc. Only in this way a new existential humanity will be born. With an explicit reference to Kierkegaard, Ricci postulates the concept of open work. A single building or a city, it is inserted in the uninterrupted cycle of life, capable of fostering new human relationships, liable to be transformed by changing destination with changing needs. From these three Italian architects' searches of the through of architecture, we can learn very much, even observing their efforts to explore the boundaries of the architecture and the urban processes, and their tenacity in turning a painful story into a creative opportunity. Their different thoughts are united by fil rouge, characterized by three components: the protest, explicit or not, against the past and the present, considered unacceptable; the use of interrupted forms at various scales and with different functions, as a manifesto of a total creative renewal of architecture making, the contradictory attitude as expression of an incessant search for a new architectural language. Thank you very much for your attention.